Hey guys, welcome to Digit.in. And depending on when you're watching this, Xiaomi has announced a 75-inch QLED TV in its Q1 lineup. If you guys remember, towards the end of 2020, we saw the 55-inch QLED come up. And now this is essentially not going 65, going even bigger at 75 inches. And of course, I have with me Ishwar and Sudeep from Xiaomi, who are going to talk about the product. So before we get into the details, Ishwar, Sudeep, would you quickly like to run the viewers through some of the highlights, the key features of the new 75-inch TV?
Hi, Sameer. Great to be back on the show. So I think Sudeep is like the best person to kind of take us through this.
Oh, okay. All right. Cool. So this is our best ever that we have ever made or put together in a product. So this is our flagship TV from MI. This is a 75 inch, as the name suggests. Some of the quick features that I wanted to stress and talked about is it is loaded with features when it comes to display and visual technologies. To start with, this is a 4K QLED panel. As everybody knows, QLED brings richer, more purer colors, and also enhances the color gamut. So you get 100% NTSC color gamut thanks to the QLED panel of this. This also comes with a 120 hertz panel. This is the first time we've ever put 120 hertz in any of our TV. This is also coupled with a Reality Flow engine, which is an MEMC engine, which is also clocked at 120 hertz. So no matter what content you're feeding, it can interpolate and add frames. This is usually helpful in playing games. It also useful when you're watching sports, for that matter. Of course, it is you can toggle it on and off, so depending on what you're watching. So in movies, we recommend to turn this off, from the picture setting. The next thing that we're doing first on this TV is introducing full array local dimming on this TV. Now, full array local dimming is essentially means we have hundreds of LEDs at the back of the TV. It's a direct LED TV. With full array local dimming, we break these LEDs into multiple zones. We have 192 of them. What this essentially means, you can turn on and off these particular zones to give you a richer contrast. So this TV comes with 10,000:1 dynamic contrast ratio. This is very, very useful when you're watching high dynamic content, be it Dolby Vision, HDR, HDR 10 plus. This really shines out. I think once the TV is out there, you guys should go and check it out if you can, depending on the situation in your cities. And to top it all off, we also have a 30 watts audio system. This is not just two drivers. These are six dedicated drivers, three on each sides, to give you a fuller sound, because the speaker box itself is a huge 1 liter cavity. These are speakers that we design in-house, and then we tune it accordingly, depending on the audio that we listen to here in India. So this all combines. We have some of our tuning that we do in India, which kind of makes this TV stands out from any other, say, equivalent TV, which is our Vivid Picture Engine. Now, Vivid Picture Engine is nothing but our algorithm or the tuning that we do in-house here, where we watch content from streaming applications and, feed content from HDMI source. These are not standard test videos. These are general videos that you and I might be watching. So we do our tuning based on real world content that is available, and then we tune everything. We have a base tuning, and then from there we go up, do the Dolby Vision, HDR, and HDR 10 plus tuning for this TV. So yeah, all of this great hardware comes with amazing software experience, because all this great hardware will mean nothing if you don't have a great software experience. I think that's something that we have been doing since 2018. Patchwall was started with that vision to make content experience or discovery of content or usage of smart TV very, very simple and easy. And we have come a long way, as you might have seen it. Patchwall is one of the best UI experience that you can get on any TV, any smart TV today, for that matter. And we make it very simple and easy to discover content. A quick example, we have a lot of HDR content out there, but it's very difficult to know where to go, what content is in HDR, right? So what we make is we make easy collection cards right on homepage, where you can go and just click and discover all of this content. We have extended this to IPL as we speak. We have extended this to different movies in genres. We have language universe. So the one concept can be again expanded to multiple use cases, which we do to enhance sort of people to experience and find the right content to enjoy the big screen experience that everybody has been looking for, especially with the current situation going on. We all want a bigger cinematic sort of experience back at home. So yeah, in summary, all of this is in, you know, again, all of these are packed into this great device. We at and the whole team is super proud of what we have managed to put together this time. So that's pretty much to summarize what we have built for, which is the Mi QLED TV 75 inch.
So the immediate next question is, like, you have packed in so much into this TV, and 75 inch is huge. I mean, you need a lot of space in your house to be able to, you know, put it in. So why go with such a big screen size? I mean, you could have come up with, let's say, a pro version of the 55 inch or a 65 inch with, you know, all these features, especially something like full array backlighting, of course, enhances the experience quite multifold compared to a direct lit panel, you know. So why go with such a big screen size rather than, you know, bringing more features to 65, 55, which are more popular screen sizes?
So I think maybe I'll take that question. I'll try to answer it in two ways, right? So one, in terms of, let's say, what consumer needs are, and two, in terms of, let's say, meeting that, and then two, in terms of how we see the market evolving. So I'll talk about the consumer need. Also, let's say, an unserved need, right? So if you look at every year, we've been looking at solving one particular unserved or underserved need for the consumer. For example, when we launched in 2018, we saw that there was a huge opportunity for a large screen 55-inch 4K, right? So 4K and 55 as a segment was not even there. So we launched that. In 2019, we came up with a 65-inch TV. Because at that time, that was one of the let's say, segments which had the least selection. There weren't too many options. Followed by our launch, we saw a lot of competition launching more 65-inch models. And in beginning of this year, end of last year, we launched the QLED. And the reason for launching QLED was very simple, because people were actually demanding a lot more from the TVs in terms of having a cinematic experience. That all of us are in is also kind of getting more and more difficult, which means that people are not able to go out and enjoy entertainment the way they used to enjoy it. So we thought, how can we, let's say, create an experience as close to a theater as possible? And that's how we kind of got into QLED as a technology, and we launched the 55. Looking at the response that we got for 55, and also a lot of consumers have been asking for a larger screen size, we thought we will come up with a 75-inch. 65, we already have it from Redmi. From a selection standpoint, we had Mi 65, now we have Redmi 65. So it made more sense to kind of get into another category and disrupt. Now coming to the second part, which is about, let's say, how this market is, right? So if you look at 75 as a market, whenever we enter into new segments, which I think we've never been present, we look at, let's say, US markets and China markets to understand how the consumer behavior has evolved. And if you look at those markets, in China, 32 as a screen size is very, very small. It's less than 5% or less than 7% of the total market. There, 55 inch is the second biggest segment. 65 and 75 are the biggest, fastest growing segments there. It is still in the top five, and it is actually fastest growing. And there, people have started asking for 86 inches and 98 inches TV, right? And we do offer those screen sizes there as well. Now, if I have to look at India as a market is almost 2 to 3 years behind US and China in terms of, let's say, consumer adoption. So we believe that this is the right time where, let's say, the 75 market can go to the next level. And the fact that there isn't enough selection for 75 also means that we will be able to make a significant impact in the segment. So two reasons, right? So one is we believe consumers are asking for it. Two, we believe this is going to be the trend. And this is also something that's not there in our portfolio. So we kind of chose to launch the 75 inch.
Yeah, so see, you make the point as in looking forward, right? It's like Henry Ford said, if I asked people what they wanted, they would say faster horses. So we're you're kind of actually kind of creating a demand while also offering that product. So you've spoken a little bit about market research. Can you elaborate on that and highlight, like you said, 32 inches no longer in demand in a country like China. And I'm pretty sure in the next half a decade or more, it'll be the same situation in India. Excuse me. So from your market research, can you talk a little bit about the growth of the various screen sizes and how you guys have evolved with it? Like, what's the state of the 50, 55 inch market today, the 43 inch market today, 65 inch also since Redmi came? And do you have any analysis, any numbers that you can share with, you know, the percentage of growth these screen sizes have had year on year, especially last year, considering people want more cinematic experience at home?
Sure. So I'll try to keep it much more. I'll try to give a higher view, and then maybe we can deep dive because I don't want to, let's say, bore your audience with too much numbers as well. So at the top level, if you look at 2018, when we launched, 24 inch was the biggest screen size. 24 inch was almost 50% of the market. So the total market size has not changed much. So in 2018, there were about 11 million TVs that were getting sold, 11 to 12 million. Even now, 11 to 12 million TVs are getting sold. There are two significant changes that have happened. One, this proportion of smart and non-smart has changed significantly. In 2018, it used to be less than 20%. Now it is over 60%. And majority of this growth has been driven by Mi TV coming into the space. And we've also gained a lot. And that's how we've been able to sell about 6 million smart TVs in the last 3 years. The second biggest shift that we've seen is 24 inch used to dominate that segment. 50%, almost 6 million TVs in 2018 sold by 24 inch. Now it is actually less than 5%. So that segment, if you remember the point that I mentioned about China, how 32 has kind of gone nowhere, is exactly what has happened to 24 inch in our country. Now 32 inch is actually the big dog, right? It's kind of 50% of the market is 32. So almost 6 million TVs that are being sold are 32 inch. 3 years ago, 32 inch used to be 30% of the market. Now 40 and 43 contributes to 28% of the market. So you see the parallel, right? So you see that,
yeah.
And given an option, and this is something that we've seen in smartphones over and over again, right? Because given an option, people will always want to move to a larger screen size because that is where you can get, let's say, the best entertainment, right? And for the same kind of value, if you're getting a larger screen size, people would always prefer that. So these are the two major ones, right, which contribute to almost 80% of the market. So at a top level, two models contributing to 80% has not changed. What has changed is 24 is replaced by 32, 32 is replaced by 40, 43. So it's only natural that maybe in 2024, the 32 might be replaced by 40 and 43, and then 55 becomes the second dominant, let's say, screen size in India. Another data point that kind of adds more merit to this argument is the growth of greater than 43 segment, right? Essentially a 4K segment, which is your 43, 4K, 50, 4K, 55, 4K and greater sizes. It used to be 5% of the total market in 2018. Now it is 17% of the market. So this is the segment where the maximum growth has happened. So if you look at the total units of TVs that are getting sold in this country, it has not changed much. However, the value of, let's say, the TV that is getting sold has been increasing year over year due to multiple factors. One, there's also been a price increase, which is due to external factors. Two, because people are also looking to move to larger screen sizes, because TV, again, is something that people see as a long-term investment for over 3 to 5 years. So people are open to kind of taking an affordability option and saying that, okay, I'll not go for a 40, I'll go to a 43. I'll not go for a 43 to a 50 because I'm anyway going to keep the TV for the next 4 to 5 years. So I think these are some interesting trends that we are noticing. And that's one of the reasons why we believe, let's say, larger screen sizes is going to get more and more popular.
Okay. Yep. That makes sense. Grow bigger, go bigger. So now coming back to the model at hand, which is a 75-inch QLED. Sudeep, you said that it has a 120 hertz panel. So does that mean if I have a PS5, and I hook it up with HDMI 2.1 cable, I can play the games at 120 hertz like the console can? Or is it still limited to 4K at 60 via HDMI 2.1?
Let me take a step back, right? So when we were designing this product, it was almost like a year ago when we were discussing and finalizing this product. So yes, we wanted to go even bigger, like Yusha mentioned. And we wanted to put even a higher refresh rate panel. However, the chipset that we have, it can only decode a 4K 60. This because the chipset that was available back then when we designed this was there. And when we did dipstick, I think a lot of people were comfortable from a gaming perspective, right? They were still like, okay, 1080p gaming is still like the most dominant in from a gamer's perspective. And fork and PS5 was nowhere. I mean, we knew that is gonna come. So
I'm still trying my luck
to get a hands-on, but yeah, hopefully by end of this year. So 4K 120, yes. So from a gameplay PS perspective, yes, that's something which is very new, very, very, very niche right at the moment. But we, again, we know that that ecosystem will grow in the coming years. However, the TV that we're talking about, it can decode 4K 60. However, like I mentioned, we have an MEMC technology, right? The Reality Flow Engine. That can interpolate and make the gameplay to match the content frame rate to the screen. So natively, if you want to, you have two choices. You can choose 1080p, 120 hertz, if you are all about the high refresh rate. But if you are all about the resolution, you want the clarity, you can go for 4K 60. So you have two options. And again, for PC gamers, there's also an intermediate option, a 1440p. So 1440p 120 will also be supported if, say, you have the graphics card, which can support it. So that's the state of where the QLED TV is.
Okay. Sticking with the features that come now, you guys were the first to kind of introduce eARC and auto low latency mode on a more budget offering with the 55-inch QLED that came. 2021 is the first year where we've actually seen a lot of good panel technology from the higher end brands. Like you see a lot of great stuff from the Sony, Samsung, LGs of the world, but their panel technology had kind of flatlined for the past 5 years. This year, they have, from CES, what we saw virtually, they've done some really great stuff when it comes to improving panel quality. And we've seen over the years that technology trickles down. And you guys have kind of tried to be at the forefront of ensuring that the best comes when it can at an affordable price. So where do you see this going in the future with, newer innovations coming at a cheaper price point? And will you see, let's say, now all the Redmi TVs have auto low latency mode and eARC, you can take it for granted, right? So where do you see these newer technologies trickling down to the more affordable options and homogenizing it? And what's next that you guys are looking to bring? Like maybe, local dimming will now probably be the next thing that you guys will have on more models coming forward, right?
I think you're right, absolutely right, right? Like TV technology, it's all about the display technology, right? That's the most look forward to. However, from a technology changing or improving, it takes a longer period in the space of TV. For example, from when we went for CRT to LED, right? Like the TVs was becoming thinner and thinner. And then it was all about full HD screens. The next trend was the 4K content that was coming. So now you see we introduced 4K in 2020 and we expanded it lineup. And now we have Redmi and Mi serving the 4K segment. You are absolutely right. Some of the technologies have trickled down. We try to do that. That's one of the reasons why we have now two lineups, the Mi and the Redmi. So the Mi will always focus on bringing the latest, the best technology out there. For example, now we have 120 hertz refresh rate screen. We have a full array local dimming for the first time ever. But what we did with Redmi, we also wanted to trickle some of the technology. So HDR technology like Dolby Vision, the HDR 10 Plus, which are very, very premium technology, was only seen in really expensive TVs out there. So we brought that. Along with that, we also got the capabilities of some of the HDMI 2.1 features, like you mentioned, ALLM, eARC, which works out of the box, right? It'll work with even a PS4 for that matter, the low latency mode. eARC is an enhanced audio. So there are already sound bars out there which will support this technology. So we want to bring some of this technology. And the way we obviously do this is look at what is out there. For example, what is the next thing that we can bring? Like you mentioned, again, far field mic is something that we have introduced with this Mi QLED TV, where you don't even no longer need to pick up a remote just to say, open an application or mute the TV. So we are looking at some of these technologies, maybe trickle down to even more of the TV. So maybe, I don't know, I mean, there are various display technologies, but there are also these supporting technologies which makes that experience better on a TV. So why not bring some of those technologies and make the experience and make it more accessible to all the people. So that is always been our vision to with this dual brand strategy right now. So maybe, I don't know, maybe hopefully soon we will get see far-field mics in even more TVs.
True. Maybe a Dolby Atmos soundbar also coming from you guys in the near future to accompany the TV, you know, because I saw you put something out on Twitter, which I thought was great. Was first is, when the Dolby Atmos stuff only comes up when you connect a Dolby Atmos soundbar. It makes no sense to just give that pop up for brand sake, because you still have just two speakers on a TV, right? The one thing that you tweeted out was switch to stereo instead of 5.1. When you're watching content on an OTT platform. That's something that we do so instinctively. It's like a no-brainer, but putting it out there really helps people get better audio out there. So Dolby Atmos soundbar coming from Xiaomi soon. Tell me that's true.
we are a very small team. We try to focus and try to do justice by whatever project that we pick up. So TV has been the most priority. You can see it clearly. Like we have Redmi now. We're trying to do as much as we can in that space. Not saying that we'll never do it, but yeah, the focus right now is on the TV side. We also have a streaming devices to bring, you know, more and more people connected, even though say they might have a good working television out there. So the focus has been to enhance the experience from a TV perspective. Soundbar is a very small market, to be honest. And also it's commoditized, right? Like people, I think it's very hard to explain people what a good sound is. I think you and I, maybe we'll hear those notes and we will appreciate, you know, the audio experience. I don't know, a lot of people will they have to experience that to know that, okay, this is great. I think that's also very hard from a product marketing perspective, if I may say so. So yeah, I mean, audio is very, very niche. I'm talking about a good audio experience is very, very few people appreciate it. But yeah, again, like I said, when we have the time and we have the enough resources, yeah, why not make one?
Absolutely. Now coming to the $1 million question, while we are recording this, just to let you guys know, we're recording this before Xiaomi has actually launched the 75-inch TV. So we don't know the price yet, but Ishwar, just to talk about pricing of the TV. So first of all, there is the whole global chip shortage, which is affecting prices. There are other factors, which I'm sure you're going to explain as to why TVs are getting more and more expensive, right? Like when you launched the MiQ LED TV, it was closer to 55,000, now it's at 57,000. And there are a lot of external factors that you say are at play. And it may not be as simple as saying, you know, a 75-inch TV is twice as big as 55-inch. So let's just X2 and, you know, get the price. So can you talk a little bit about what's happening in the market when it comes to these chip shortages or panel problems and how that's affecting TV manufacturing, TVs that are made in India, considering you guys are making these in India, and, you know, the benefits and the compromises that happen to the price point?
Got it. So I'll split the question into two, right? So one, there is the overall issue around the TV pricing, which I'll try to clarify. So the second one, where we go specifically into 75, and I want to break some myths around, let's say large screen prices, what is consumer's expectation versus what is actually in reality. So first I'll address, let's say, the issue with respect to the TV pricing, right? And you were very accurate when you said we launched it at 55K in January, and I think about a week ago, we had to increase the prices by 2,000 rupees. So there are actually three factors in play right now, right? So the first one is the OC shortage. So OC is open cell, which is basically the LCD layer in the display. And this component costs almost 50 to 60% of the total BOM cost for any TV, right? So this is one single biggest cost component in a TV. And then the demand for the panels have been going up. One of the main reasons is because of, let's say, the extended COVID lockdowns that the world has been facing. Well, India has been getting affected really bad recently, but the world has been kind of facing it for the last 1 year. And the OC facility or the factories that make OC actually make it for TVs, computer, laptop monitors, let's say your PC monitors and tablets. Right, so smartphone manufacturing is completely different, and all the other devices, all the large screen devices kind of share the same facility, because the demand for laptops and all the displays kind of went up across the world. There was like a genuine shortage because supply could not ramp up, and that resulted in a supply demand gap, and so the prices increased. The recent issue that has happened in the last few months is there is this, so the main mode of a TV is connected to the OC through, let's say, something called a TCON chip, right? And the TCON chip also has some IC in it. And I'm sure all of you would have heard about, let's say, the IC shortages, which Qualcomm is talking about, TSMC is talking about, everybody is talking about, right? And they are talking about an IC shortage in, let's say, your 5 nanometers and like highly sophisticated IC. This IC is not very sophisticated, right? Again, it obviously is like sophisticated, but it's also dated. It's based on a 22-meter or a 26-nanometer architecture, whereas all your latest ICs are based on 5 nanometer. And all the new fabrications that are also kind of put to kind of make more chips are also in the new 5 nanometer, because obviously nobody's going to invest resources in an architecture which is outdated. So which means that the demand for TV and all the, so all these TCON use a 22 nanometer, let's say IC. And then the demand, since the TV has been going up, nobody is adding new factories. So this price is also kind of going up. So this price, while is not as incremental, because I said the OC is 50%, this is not so expensive, but still people are now in, let's say, queue, because not everybody is able to kind of get access to TCON. And this we believe might actually disrupt, let's say, our supplies in Q3 and Q4, right? So we are kind of preparing backups to kind of avoid that scenario. And finally, the third issue, which is very recent, is how, let's say, the dollar has suddenly started appreciating against the rupee. So I think the last time when we discussed, I think not even the Redmi, right? So when we were discussing for the preceding, which was about like 10 days ago, dollar was 73 rupees. Now it has actually gone up to 75.6. Right? And that's almost like a 4% increase. All the raw materials, even though we make in India, you will have to buy it globally, because the raw material ecosystem is not available in India. I think that's something that I want to emphasize to all your listeners as well. Though we make everything in India, we have to procure these parts from different vendors. Some of the vendors are in China, some of them are in Hong Kong. And there is certain local procurement that happens in India, but still majority of the procurement still happens from outside. So all the outside procurement are denominated in dollars, which means that there is a straightaway 3-4% hit. And that 3-4% is something that we cannot absorb, because as a company, you know that our prices have always been less than like a 3-4% level in terms of the net profit, right? That's something that we always maintain. So we'll have to pass that prices on. This has happened in all SKUs. We've increased prices only in 2 SKUs. So we are kind of waiting and watching, but we believe in the next 2 months or 3 months, we expect the prices to go up, and not just for us, but overall. So that's the first part, right? So the three reasons why prices are increasing: the OC price going up, there is a TCON shortage that is kind of also driving the demand higher, while your supply is not able to scale up. And then finally, USD, INR, which is again a very localized issue, but it's impacting, let's say, all electronics. It's not just, let's say, TVs. Now coming to 75. So 75, I think it's almost like a chicken and egg problem, right? I think your first question was why you're launching a 75. And ironically, when we launched the 32 Smart, I think we also got the same question saying, why are you not launching a 24 inch? Because 24 was the biggest screen size then, right? And that was exactly the Ford question that you mentioned, right? It's a beautiful example, right? People always think that, okay, what works right now will continue to work. But we all know that when you look at the trends, I mean, if you don't adapt, somebody is going to come and disrupt. But on 75, I kind of digress, but on 75, one of the main expectations or the reason why 75 as a segment is not so big is due to like two or three reasons, right? So this is what I kind of, let's say, have as a hypothesis. The first one, there isn't enough selection for 75. If I kind of ask you, what is the top selling 55? What is your favorite 55, 65? I'm sure you will be able to give 5 to 7 options. And most people will be able to tell me, let's say, what is the 55 model which is more popular. But when it comes to 75, and even when we were doing the research, we were not able to find even a single 75 model. Not, let's say, our, let's say, media colleagues, or even our distributors, or let's say consumer electronics partners, right? So 75, there isn't enough selection. That's as simple. Second, most of the 75 that comes into India are imported, right? For us, from day one, we were very clear, if you want to get 75, we'll have to make it in India, because we believe, it adds, let's say, value in terms of developing that ecosystem in India. Two, it also brings down the cost. So which means that it becomes more accessible to the consumers. But for competition, what we see is most of it is imported, which means that additional duty or let's say that cost also gets added. So which makes it little not accessible, right? When you make a 55 in India and when you import a 75, the gap even widens. And the third one, I think, is a consumer perception issue, for which I'll share some data to kind of, let's say, take you through it. Because I think this is something that even I used to have, right, before I joined this category. In terms of, I used to think, okay, 32-inch, and I'm talking about 5-7 years before, right? So people used to think 32-inch means you have to pay 32,000 rupees. 43-inch means you have to pay 40,000. 50-inch is 55,000. 60-inch is 70,000, so forth. So basically, that 1-inch is 1,000 is a perception. But that math starts breaking down once you go above 55-inch, right? And the reason is very simple, right? I think people are looking at the wrong metric. So I'll just kind of show. I've just taken some market examples, right? Because obviously I cannot share what is the price of the 75 QLED. So essentially, we've taken three models from competition, and so the only difference between the three models is the screen size. Everything else is pretty much the same, right? So, and these are the different prices that are there. What I've done here is I've just calculated what is the price per inch. This is the usual calculation. Let's say 1600 rupees for a 43-inch, it goes up to the same per inch cost actually increases, right? And here I've actually calculated what is the price per square inch. So area is nothing but a 43-inch TV has a 790 square inches of area, right? In terms of viewable area that is available, assuming a 16:9, and all these TVs are 16:9. So this final table that you see here indexes this value so that everything is at a comparable base, right? And I'll tell you the reason why I'm indexing. So for example, all of this is indexed to 1600 because I've assumed that the 1600 rupees is the per inch value for a TV. So which essentially means when it goes to 75 inch, it almost becomes like 3x. Mm-hmm. Here, what I've said is like 87 rupees is what consumers pay per square inch of a particular TV. And that goes up to 161. Now, this table, I'll put it in a graph, which is much easier to understand. When you actually look at a screen size level, you will not see any kind of a pattern because we are actually looking at the wrong metric. At a 43 inch, it says 1600. It goes as high as, let's say, 3x for some brands. And even for the same brand, it goes from 1 to almost 1.5, 1.6. But if you look at an area level, you see that almost everything is fitting within this band. Right. And the point that I'm trying to prove is your BOM cost is dependent on the area and not the screen size. So it's not like we are increasing the screen size and actually reducing the, we're not making it lengthwise, right? We are also maintaining the 16:9. If you made 75 and actually made it, let's say 27:9, then maybe we could maintain the same cost. But that's not what we are doing. And I think this is something that consumers also miss. So essentially the point I'm trying to say is but still there are some outliers and this outlier is explained by import. Because this math will also break. If let's say you're making this locally 43 and 50, and if you're importing this, obviously the import will kind of not fit this particular band. But yeah, I think that the core that I'm trying to say is the area is something that we'll have to figure out. For example, a 55 inch has this area of 1300 square inch, which is almost, we have almost 2x that area in a 75 inch. And 75 inch is roughly almost 3x that of a 43. So you almost, and this is something that people don't get to experience because not a lot of stores actually have a 75 inch next to a 55. So for example, one of our colleagues had a 75 inch next to his laptop and the laptop looked like a smartphone. Because in terms of scale, people, it's very hard for people to know scale, right, before actually seeing this. I mean, so I think it just boils down to that. So long story short, so one, the overall ecosystem is in such a way that the prices are going up. And for 75 specifically, it has 2x the area of, let's say, a 55. And to answer your specific question, right, without giving out the price, the 55 is priced at 57,000 rupees, like you said. So this one has 2x the area of that. It's got full array local dimming. It's got a 120 hertz refresh rate panel. It's got far field mics. So everywhere we've kind of upgraded the whole TV. And there's obviously, in terms of, let's say, assembling a 75 versus a 55, 75 takes more time and effort as well. So essentially, you have that as a base, which is like at least 2-2.5x of 55. And if you look at the global pricing of our TVs, our global pricing, while the launch pricing was 1199 euros, currently it is retailing close to 1799 euros, right? Which roughly translates to about 1.6. So this is the range that we have. So you can assume that we would be launching somewhere in this range.
Absolutely. Yep. That is just way too much that goes into devising the price of a product. It is just too complicated. And then it's great that we have an explanation to give people some ideas to, hey, you know, this is what goes behind it. I remember when the new consoles were first announced, both of them got rid of the optical port, and people who had home theaters and headphones with optical were going crazy. And Phil Spencer from Microsoft said it very simply: if it cost me $1 to put in optical port in the console, and if I'm making 1 million consoles, that's $1 million that I'm spending. So it's never about just, you know, that one component and the fact that it costs $1. So yeah, this actually adds a lot of good insight into how pricing of television works. So those are most of the questions that I had. Is there anything else that you would like to talk about the new TV that we may not have discussed so far?
No, I think only one thing, right? We are very, very thankful to a lot of your feedbacks, specifically Samir, and then also to all the Mi fans. I think it has helped us to, let's say, get better almost on a daily basis, right? In terms of, let's say, pushing us. I think 75 has been the most ambitious effort from our team. We are also kind of, let's say, very thrilled and excited. It's almost like we're like the movie stars waiting for our release. And it's also happening on a Friday. Given the current situation, there isn't a lot of cheer. We are also praying for, let's say, the entire country to kind of get back on its feet. But I think tomorrow we are launching it. Hope all of you stay safe and watch the event. And looking forward to your feedback on the TV.
Yep, absolutely. It is currently in office, and as soon as I can get the transport and create the space in my house, I'm going to get it shipped right here and check it out. And then we'll have our review live as soon as we can. So stay tuned for that. So Sudeep, anything else that you want to add before we sign off?
No, that's pretty much sums up. It's the best that we have ever tried to make. And we hope this will live up to a lot of people's expectation, including yours. And as usual, I look forward to reading and watching your review, because it also helps consumers to make that decision if they need to invest. It also helps us shape and define a lot of things in the future, right? A product is not about adding ABCD. It's a product is about the experience. So we look forward that the more and more people, like Isha mentioned, they will try to go to a bigger size, and we have tried to do our best to get the best specs that possible in a particular segment. And obviously the prices will be announced by the time the viewers will read, and hopefully they will really like what we have put together as a team.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to all the stories. Like there was this one person about 2 years ago on Twitter who went really insane tweeting about the fact that he bought an 85 or an 86 inch TV from somewhere and it did not fit in the service elevator in his apartment, and he had to go and return it. So I want to know how many people are going to kind of, you know, say, my, you know, check the strength of the wall when they wall mount such a big TV or the service elevator. I mean, you guys have said it takes 3 people to set it up on the stand. So I'm most looking forward to all the quirky stories that come out from this, because that's the most fun. But on the more serious note, it's great. Stuff like local dimming is something that was saved for premium TVs. You guys have brought it, even if, you know, 75 inch TV is premium price. I'm sure this is something you guys are going to launch this year or next year on the 55, 65 more affordable TVs. You guys have done that, raised our expectations of what Xiaomi does with its TVs. So that's great. I am personally looking forward to you guys doing something in the audio space as well, because I really think a good TV really deserves a good soundbar with it. You know, there's just like some magic that happens there when you're watching a movie at home. And it's great. I mean, you guys have also announced more products apart from the TV. The Mi 11 family of devices is coming to India as well. So great. I mean, you know, it's a distraction. Like Ishwar said, yes, these are tough times. And, you know, looking forward to these launches and, you know, checking out these products, it kind of distracts you from the news of what's happening and kind of gives you a good evening on a Friday. So thank you so much for joining us. And for the rest of you, if you guys have any questions, as always, let us know in the comment section below. If you want us to check out something specific in these TVs, let us know. As of recording this, the current TV that is under review with me is the Redmi TV, which I'm going to be checking out right now over this weekend. So stay tuned for that review coming up as well. Thank you so much for joining us. And for more from the world of technology, you can subscribe to the channel. We will catch you in another video. It's goodbye for now.